أكبر الله أكبر لا إله إلا الله الله أكبر الله أكبر ولله الحمد إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله أما بعد يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله ولا حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر Today is Eid al-Adha, one of two Eids that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has legislated to this ummah as a means to thank Allah for His bounties, for the countless bounties that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given mankind in general and this ummah in particular. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لِيَذْكُرُوا اللَّهَ فِي أَيَّامٍ مَعْدُودَاتٍ عَلَى مَا رَزَقَهُمْ مِنْ بَهِيمَةِ الْأَنْعَامِ So that they may remember and mention Allah much in a certain number of days for the cattle that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has provided for them. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants His slaves to thank Him for the bounties that He has given them. And in this world, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has a sunnah that if mankind wants to achieve success in this world and the hereafter, then they have to work hard for it. They have to work hard for it. You cannot just claim to be a Muslim or a Christian or a Jew and say that I'm going to go to Jannah just because I am a Muslim or just because I am a Christian or just because I am a Jew. No, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has legislated to this ummah the same way He has legislated to the nations before us, that before you achieve success, before you achieve Jannah, you have to pay it forward. You have to work hard. You have to have patience. That's why the two Eids that we have in this ummah are preceded by worships, by types of worship that may be difficult for some people that have some types of hardship as a means for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to test the people, to show those that are true in faith to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as opposed to the ones who just say good things with their mouths while their hearts are empty. Eid al-Fitr, we endure the fasting for a whole month before we are able to say that we are in a state of celebration, before we are happy with whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us. Similarly, during the Eid al-Adha, the second Eid in the year, a Muslim is commanded to undertake a lot of good actions in the 9 days preceding the 10th day of Dhul Hijjah, when Eid is. Also among these actions are fasting, which as we said is hard for human beings because the human soul is used to easiness and to luxury of life. Similarly, before Eid al-Adha, people undergo the difficult journey of Hajj, where they travel from faraway lands and they change the environment they are used to. They change the houses that they are living in. They change the people that they are hanging out with during these days. And then they go to Mina in the hardship of being in tents. Maybe it was there's scorch and heat. Also, there is the hardship of moving to Arafah and staying there all day and making dua. And then going to Muzdalifah and spending the night there, you know, in tents. For when people, especially in this day and age, are used to the luxuries that we know. So after this hardship, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala legislates for them to give an offering, a sheep, as a means to show their thanks to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as a means to show that they believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because sacrificing a lamb is legislated for this ummah, the same was legislated for the Jews and Christians before us. Now, what is the history behind this sacrificial lamb that we offer as a means to get close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? It is from the time of Ibrahim alayhi salam. Ibrahim al-Khalil, who was the close friend of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when his people used to worship statues, and he went against his own society. He was the only one who was believing in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He was the only one who was monotheist, and yet he stood firm against his own father and against his whole tribe, and against all the practices that they were used to as far as worshiping statues. And he told them that I shall worship Allah alone. And as a result, they used their might to oppress him, and they threw him into a fire, meaning to finish his life and finish his protest for the sake of Allah. However, Ibrahim alayhi salam, he said, Hasbi Allahu ni'mal wakil. Allah is enough for me, and he is the best disposer of affairs. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered this fire to be cold and peace for Ibrahim alayhi salam, so that the fire does not become very cold and harm Ibrahim alayhi salam, because the fire was ordered by Allah, and the fire is going to be quick to obey Allah's command. Similarly, after that, the Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam, after he was saved from the fire, he told his people, Inni dhahibun ila rabbi sayahdeen. Verily, I am going to my Lord. He will guide me. We ask Allah to guide us the same way He guided Ibrahim alayhi salam and Muhammad alayhi salam, all the prophets before him. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. Then Ibrahim alayhi salam, he became old, and he was not given by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala any children. So he made dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He said, Rabbi habli min as-salihin. My Lord, grant me offspring from the righteous. In other words, not only an offspring, but a righteous offspring. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him a glad tiding of a forbearing boy, Ghulam Halim, forbearing boy. And when Ismail alayhi salam was old enough to walk with him, Ibrahim alayhi salam was given the revelation that he should sacrifice his own son, his beloved son, that was given to him after an old age. And you know, especially when a father is given a son after old age, he is very attached to that son because he has been longing for him throughout his life. And all of a sudden, he has this son that he loves. He has grown up. He is helping his father. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, فَلَمَّا بَلَغَ مَعَهُ السَّعِي. That means Ismail alayhi salam was old enough to help his father in the chores that the father usually needed his son to do. And he was given the revelation that Ibrahim, you need to sacrifice your son for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ibrahim alayhi salam did not hesitate, did not say this is only a dream, did not say, well, what kind of religion is this? Well, why would Allah order me to sacrifice my son? No, Ibrahim alayhi salam was quick to obey. So he went to his son, he says, Ya bunayya inni ara fil manami anni adbahuk, fanzur madha tara. He said, oh my son, I have seen in a dream that I am slaughtering you, offering you in sacrifice to Allah. So look, what do you think about the matter? Because visions and dreams for prophets are revelation, as is known from Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam and also from Muhammad alayhi salatu salam. So there are different means of revelations. One of them is an actual vision in the dream. So Ismail alayhi salam, he said, Ya abati fa'al ma tu'mar, satajiduni insha'Allahu min as-sabirin. Oh my father, do that which you are commanded. Insha'Allah, you shall find me among the sabirun, the patient. So this son was not saying, hey father, what are you telling me? You tell me to worship Allah, officer, you tell me you're going to kill me? He did not argue with him. He did not even hesitate. He says, my father, because he trusted his father, was on the right path, and he did not question him. So he says, oh my father, do what you are commanded, because this son was a forbearing son, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said. He wanted what's good for himself and of his father, and he knew that his father loved him so much, and he would not order him to do something except there is in his own benefit. He did not question these things. He did not go looking for fatwa saying halal, haram. He did not argue with his father. He says, Ya abati, if'al ma tu'mar. Do what you are commanded. Here we're talking about a sacrifice. We stress on this point. We're talking about a sacrifice. The father tells his son, I'm going to slaughter you. He did not tell him, oh my son, I just want you to not study here. I do not want you to just go to this place or that place. He told him, I'm going to slaughter you. And yet his son did not argue with him. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. الحمد لله وكفى وسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى ونصلي ونسلم على نبينا محمد وعلى آله أجمعين أما بعد. So Ibrahim عليه السلام, he ordered his son, actually he conferred with his son. He says, what do you say, O my son? And then the son was submissive to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the same way his father was, like father, like son. And then when they both submitted themselves to Allah, and Ibrahim alayhi salam laid his son prostrate on his forehead or on the side of his forehead for slaughtering. The scholar said that Ibrahim alayhi salam made his son put his head towards the floor because he was afraid that when he was about to slaughter him, if he looks at his son's face, he may feel weak. That's why they said that Ibrahim alayhi salam told him to prostrate himself, to put his head towards the floor. And then Ibrahim alayhi salam took the knife and started slaughtering his own son. So not only an intention, an actual action. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered the knife to not cut the flesh. And Ibrahim alayhi salam was called, Ya Ibrahim, qad saddaqta ar-ru'ya. Ibrahim, you have fulfilled the vision. You have fulfilled the vision. That's it. The test is over. He was successful in the test. Him and his son Ismail alayhi salam. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, this is how we reward the good doers. So of course this was a huge test. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّ هَذَا لَهُوَ الْبَلَاءُ الْمُبِينُ. Surely this is the true test, because to order a father to slaughter his son is a very difficult order. And yet Ibrahim alayhi salam and Ismail alayhi salam did not flinch, not only for one moment, because they were the true monotheists submitted to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, knowing that any command that comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is for their own good. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, verily there is indeed a manifest trial. And we ransomed him with a great sacrifice, which was a ram, you know, a huge sheep. The scholars said that this sheep grazed in Jannah for 40 years. For 4 years before he was brought down to earth, and Ibrahim alayhi salam sacrificed him instead of sacrificing his own son. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and we left for him a good remembrance among later generations. Truly, look at us. Thousands of years of Ibrahim alayhi salam, and we still mention him as an example for mankind, for goodness, him and his son Ismail alayhi salam. And we know this is not the only time where Ismail alayhi salam showed total obedience to his father. We know that the time when Ibrahim alayhi salam went to Ismail alayhi salam, and Ismail's wife did not know Ibrahim alayhi salam. So he asked her, how is your livelihood? She told him, you know, we are living a difficult life. And she started complaining to this total stranger person. So Ibrahim alayhi salam told her, when Ismail alayhi salam comes, tell him to change the doorstep of his house. And then when Ismail alayhi salam came and his wife told him what happened, he told her, you are the doorstep of my house. My father has ordered me to divorce you. So he divorced her. And Allah gave him another wife. So here again, an order from a father. Why? Because this his father knew that this wife is bad for his own son. A wife that is always complaining to a complete stranger instead of thanking Allah. You know, she's alive. She has complete limbs. She's able to speak. She's able to see and still not thanking Allah. All she can do, she forgets all the bounties that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given her and complains about the small, meaningless, worldly things that they may not have. Like them, like everyone else. So Ibrahim alayhi salam ordered his son to divorce that wife because he knew that that wife is not good for him. Ismail alayhi salam obeyed his father because again, he knew that his father only wanted what is good for him. So here Ismail alayhi salam is the role model of how children should be. And we should stress these points to our children, especially for us Muslims that were given children in the West, or people that live in the West, because obviously they don't know these examples. All they know is they look at the societies that are around them, where children, they are arrogant with their parents, they yell at their parents, they tell their parents what to do. After they grow a little older, they leave their parents and don't contact them except on Mother's Day or Father's Day. So we Muslims should make sure that we narrate this good example to our children since childhood, so that perchance Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala may bless them and make them like Ismail alayhi salam, instead of making them rebellious children the same way the children in the West are. Because that's how the society is, and that's what the society encourages. We are Muslims, we have an example that is set for us in the Quran, in the Sunnah, and Ismail alayhi salam is one of these best examples. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. So my dear brothers and sisters, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless us on this day of Eid. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to enable us to teach our children how to undertake the necessary steps to find the correct path. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless us and our children and our families. Wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen.